we'll do the same, but let's see. This is also specifically more about not just MVP, but how to actually, hack your MVPs. How to come up with MVPs that are, really cheap and really help you learn something very quickly from it. Let's look at some interesting startup examples. I work in India mostly, so most of my examples are going to be from Indian context. But I don't think Sri Lanka is very different in that sense, so you probably will be able to relate to most of these examples. Let's look at the first example. Anyone's heard of this company called Greenlight? Probably not. Greenlight came up with this idea that, basically about 2 billion people today use, energy sources which are not clean, which are not green, which are, expensive and which are harmful. So their vision was to actually come up with clean energy sources, and one of the ways they wanted to do that was by using basically solar light to provide lanterns in villages, right? Most villages, if you've been, they use kerosene lights, kerosene lamps in the night to light up, right? So what these guys were trying to do is basically trying to figure out a solution that can help people move away from expensive kerosene lamps and use solar light, which is, much cheaper and much more safer and greener energy, right? Great vision, great cause. Some of these guys, so it was founded by three guys. One of them, two of them came from Google. So these are very smart individuals who have done a lot of successful product development before. So they did the market research. They found out all of this data. They found out a lot of details about what people need, what are the challenges, all of that stuff. And they went off and they built the product, right? And then they came and they went to the market with the product. And when they went to the market with the product, what did they find? They found that villagers didn't really think what they were using was expensive or hazardous. Right? How many people you would go and talk in the village and they'll think kerosene lamp is really harmful? We've been using it for so many years, what's the problem? Right? They were afraid of technology product. They said, I don't understand all this solar. You're asking me to connect, put it here. I'm not sure, this doesn't make sense. And they had other kinds of, issues where they found that the adoption of their product, which was really good, it was under 100 rupees, which is 2,000 Sri Lankan rupees. They gave a lifetime warranty. So if anything went wrong, you can return. It was dust proof, all of that stuff. You can throw it. Crash proof, all of that stuff. Very, very cool product, but really no takers, right? What was the reason, do you think? These were kind of the reasons, and there may be a lot more reasons, that people did not really want to adopt this. So what they decided is that, they still wanted to stick to their vision. They didn't want to let it go. So they said, let's try and find out why, what's the problem, what else could be done, how can we make this possible? So they went to villages, they spent a lot of time, they tried to, offer people for free, they tried to see if, that would make, if pricing was a problem, other kinds of problems. What they found is one thing that people were consistently asking them. They said, we don't need, these solar things to basically light up a house or whatever, but can you help me charge my mobile phone? So they basically took that, they pivoted the product, right, and they came up with a solar charger. By the way, it has light, right? That was the twist. It's a solar charger, but it has a light. Today they have sold over 6 billion pieces worldwide, mostly in India and in South Africa, in Africa, and they've lit up about 1 lakh villages. So very interesting study of how, they had a very interesting product, no takers. They made a small change in the product, the way they positioned it, and then suddenly it took off, the hockey stick growth. So that's kind of one quick case study. Let's look at another one. Is this company familiar to you guys? Eureka Forbes, water purifiers. What do you use here for water purifiers? Don't need one? Pureit. Okay. Eureka Forbes in India was almost synonymous. When you said Eureka Forbes, it meant like if you say Bisleri or whatever, right? Then you think of mineral water. Like that in India, when you said Eureka Forbes, it meant, you know, basically water purifiers. They were synonymous. So they were very successful in basically bringing clean water to the urban parts of India, to the metro cities of India, right? And then they wanted to look at, can we do the same in the rural parts of India? Can we bring clean water to rural parts of India? And so they said, yeah, that's a worthwhile vision to have for the company. So let's go chase that. Obviously, the product that they had built, this product, wouldn't work if they went to the villages. Why? Electricity, water pipes running all the way into the houses, you know, lots of other kinds of problem, right? And most places in the urban parts, you have to walk a few kilometers every day to go get the water from the river or from the lake or from somewhere else. It's not a pipe running into your house and other kinds of things. Obviously, these guys did their study. They figured out that this will not work. They came up with what they call as the water shops, which is basically where you go and you can buy water, right? So when they validated, when they did the pricing validation and all of that stuff, they found that, you know, instead of walking 5 kilometers, if I gave you water, 1 liter of water for 3 rupees a liter, people would come and buy the water, right? So they did all of those validations. They built, they started building all these things. They came up with a massive water purifier system, a new kind of a water purifier system, which would actually help to clean water at such large volumes and stuff like that. And they had all of this set up. They launched it in about 100 cities in India, 100 rural villages in India. And same experience. What was the experience? People came, checked out the shop, but didn't buy anything. Right? It's like the malls. You go, you check out, and then you leave. You don't buy anything. What was the reason? People didn't think the water they were drinking was harmful, because it's not like I drink water and immediately something happens. Usually when you drink contaminated water, it might take days, weeks or months or years sometime before, you know, the side effects might show up, right? What was freely available, people felt like it is not right to pay money for it, you know, other kinds of problems. So again, they had to figure out a way to make this work, because they were not willing to let go of their vision. You know, they had to do something to make it work. So what they did was basically they pivoted again to basically having a shop, all the shops where people can buy currency for the phones, can recharge their phones using the currencies. And then when they came in, they started educating them about the problems of not drinking clean water and things like that, and gradually they started educating. They even came up with an entire process which was similar to how you do a phone recharge. Like you buy a prepaid card, then you put in the number, you recharge it. So they came up with a similar workflow and all of that stuff. And then today Eureka Forbes is very popular in the rural parts of India for providing clean water. What's the moral of these two stories? Focus on mobile? Not quite. The moral of the story in some sense is inspect and adapt, or pivot, right? You need to know, not many. So I would say that these two are unicorns. These two are maybe out of a million other startups that have died, that have no one has even heard of, right? These are unicorns in that sense that they were lucky to find a model that worked and be able to catch their users early on to figure out a way to make the business model successful. Most startups don't have this luxury. Would you agree? Most startups basically go busted before they can actually get a substantial user base, right? Few years ago, I did a startup. We blew about 2 crore rupees, didn't go anywhere, shut it down, right? So based on my own experience, I can tell you how many startups basically crash before seeing this. These are unicorns. So I was in the quest of trying to find a better, cheaper way to do this, right? To do this kind of a validation. How many people are familiar with design thinking? So when I would explain this problem of mine, saying, you know, we built this, we did all of this stuff, we did a lot of customer validation, but when we actually went out, you know, customers were not willing to buy. So it was kind of surprising. They said they like it, but later they were not willing. And most people said, you know what, the problem is that you need to do better design thinking. Are you guys familiar with the term design thinking? Right? So Jeff Patton, a friend of mine, came up with this nice distillation, one slide distillation of what design thinking is. So basically, when you talk about design thinking, you have a set of passions, inspirations, whatever vision that you want to achieve. And you come up with a big idea of what you want to achieve, right? This is my vision and this is the idea. This is how I'm going to achieve my vision. This is my solution. Then you build a big prototype. You build a massive prototype and then you run big set of tests. You get a long list of learning. You iterate through this process till you find something actually works. And then you go and start building that. You start productizing that. Right, that's kind of in a nutshell the whole process behind design thinking. Now, as you can see, this the emphasis on the word big is made very clear to highlight that this could be too much of an effort in some cases. Like if you saw the previous examples, you could see that they spent a lot before they actually got real customers buying. So then came along this whole concept of lean startup. Familiar with the concept lean startup? Right, that's where the term MVP was popularized. So lean startup has a slightly different model, similar cycle, but a different model. You come up with a big idea, you highlight your riskiest assumptions and solutions and things like that. And then from there, you come up with a simple prototype which tests the most riskiest assumption, just one of them, not the whole thing. Right? And you come up with a simple prototype, you run some focus tests on them, you come up with small but significant learning, and then that pivots, that iterates, that changes your big idea, and you repeat the cycle till you figure out a business model that is viable. Right? This is nothing but what is referred to as the build, measure, learn cycle. You have an idea, you build something really small, you find out, you measure certain things, you get some data, and then from there you learn. And you iterate through this cycle till you validate a particular hypothesis. And so let me quickly talk about the bookish definition of what an MVP is. Anyone wants to chip in before I kind of talk about the MVP definition? Few people said they know what an MVP is. Can you help me define what an MVP is? This is 90-minute session, so I need to go slow. Okay, good. So a minimum set of features that anyone would be interested to use your product. That's a minimum viable product. MVP. Any other definitions? It's the smallest experiment. I like the word smallest experiment that you can run to validate if your product or your feature is viable. Viable as in if it is something people would like, something it solves the problem, if it's something people would actually pay money or anything like that, whatever your hypothesis was, you're trying to validate that. So basically what the definition says is a version of new product which allows, so you can replace the product with the service, so it's equally applicable to a product or a service. So a version of your new product or a service which allows a team to collect the maximum amount of validated learning about customers with the least amount of effort. That's kind of what the definition of an MVP says. The goal of the MVP is to obviously validate your fundamental business hypothesis. Right, fundamental business hypothesis or the leap of faith. You think that when you did this, people would just queue up outside your house to buy your product, right? That's your hypothesis. So you want to validate if that's actually true. 99.99999% it is not, right? So it's good to validate that early. Now the problem with this definition is that when you go to a company, they say we are running an MVP. They're like, great, they're doing an MVP. And then you realize that that MVP has been running for 6 months and it's nothing but their release one. And they call that as the MVP. It's of course the minimum set of features that anyone would need. Without this, we can't actually deploy anything, right? And so you could take this definition to your own advantage and call anything an MVP, and that kind of doesn't really make sense. I actually wanted to play a video.
Talk about a specific technique that my startup has used to conduct really realistic, really effective user tests of our ideas. So about a year ago, we had an idea for a social purchase sharing app where you would stream out what you're buying to your friends and they would share back with you what they were buying, and it was going to be great, and it was going to be a social networking take on product reviews. And being a lean startup, we mocked it up, static prototypes, we got it in front of a lot of people, and they said, you know, I'm not going to use it, but I can see how other people might use it. And then we heard that again and again, and we said, well, why wouldn't you use it? And they said, because I don't know which of my friends would actually use this. And it made sense. It's a social application, and if they don't see the real faces of their friends that they can emotionally connect with, they can't actually grok what it's going to be about. So I said, all right, we need to make this a more realistic test than what we've done. And we drilled down on the most important interaction on the site, which is when someone does a purchase and shares it on Facebook and it appears in their friend's newsfeed. And we're interested, would people actually click? Would they care? So we thought about, you know, how can we make this realistic? Do we have to build the whole thing and build this pretty serious sized app to do this? Or can we fake it really well? We decided to try to fake it, and the technique we used was a Grease Monkey script. So if you're not familiar with Grease Monkey, it's just a simple little JavaScript that can change the way a website appears. So here's an Amazon product page. After I installed Grease Monkey, it now pops up every time I go there a little yellow box that shows competitors' prices. So it's specific to one page, and it alters that page. So I went on rentacoder.com, described what I wanted, and I found a guy in the Philippines who was willing to build our script for $40. We sent our $40 across the ocean, and a few days later, sure enough, back came the script. And it's pretty simple. There's the whole thing right there. You just drag that into Chrome or to Firefox, and it wakes up every time it gets on its target page. So every time we went to Facebook, it would wake up and it would run itself. So the next thing we do is our standard procedure. We post an ad on Craigslist, say we're running a social media focus group. We bring people in, say, what's your favorite social media site? And invariably they'd say Facebook. We'd say, great, why don't you log into Facebook? That's a great idea. And up would pop their newsfeed, and they're feeling totally in control, seems very realistic. Their newsfeed pops up, and the Grease Monkey script runs, and it inserts fake content into their feed, and it's using their real friends' names and faces. So it's pixel perfect real. If we built the whole thing, it wouldn't have looked any different than that. And so then we sat back and said, well, are they going to notice this content that our app would normally insert into their feed? And sure enough, no prompting, they were like, wait a minute, my friend Michelle bought a Lady Gaga album, and my friend Charlie bought, you know, an iPad. And they noticed, and they reacted very strongly. Hated it. This is how Facebook is going to hell. It used to be about friends, and now it's about commercial stuff. I remember back in the day, we would share poetry, and now I hate these ads. And we did it 50 times, and there were 3 people who liked it. So it was a very different reaction than when we did the initial prototypes. And it really wasn't that hard to do. You know, it was a $40 script. So that's my main point. It, you know, don't think that you just have to do with paper. You can do something better. So one thing to explain about Grease Monkey, it only works on the computer that you're testing on. So it's good for one-on-one. We couldn't really change Facebook for the whole world. Just want to clear that up. But it can work with any page. So here's another example of how we use it. You can hack Google to insert.
You get the point, right? They drill down on what was the most important interaction and if people would notice it. And without actually having to build the whole thing, right? They were able to find a way to fake it, or what I say, hack it, such that they can get a validated learning. Now, if they run an experiment with 50 people and 47 of them, which is
90, what percent?
Ninety-four percent
of them did not like it. Then what would you do? Would you still go ahead and build the product? You would still build something, but not that thing, right? You would try and pivot. You would try and find what else would attract the people, and that's what they did. They actually had three competitors. All three went out to VCs, got a lot of money, millions of dollars were raised. They went all gangbusters building the product. These guys were pivoting, trying to find what works. And finally, when they had something that actually worked, the others basically went bankrupt. Right? So an interesting kind of study if you go and look at different people. Zappos is another company you might be familiar. It was bought by Amazon for a few million dollars, one of the very successful exits. I'm not going to go into too much details of Zappos, but the idea is they were basically selling shoes online. They were the first guys to sell shoes online. And before they actually had anything, it was just the founder went, took pictures and posted it on the site. And then whenever an order would come, he would physically go to the shop, buy the shoes and ship it. Right, and then they kind of did all of that to validate the model if it actually works before they kind of started building the website or other kinds of things. Here's another example, another video.
I'm Mike, founder of DollarShaveClub.com. What is DollarShaveClub.com? Well, for a dollar a month, we send high quality razors right to your door. Yeah, a dollar. Are the blades any good? No. Our blades are great. Each razor has stainless steel blades, an aloe vera lubricating strip, and a pivot head. It's so gentle a toddler could use it. And do you like spending $20 a month on brand name razors? 19 go to Roger Federer. I'm good at tennis.
And do you think your razor needs a vibrating handle, a flashlight, a back scratcher, and 10 blades? Your handsome ass grandfather had one blade and polio.
Looking good, pop up!
Stop paying for shave tech you don't need. And stop forgetting to buy your blades every month. Alejandro and I are going to ship them right to you. We're not just selling razors, we're also making new jobs. Alejandro, what were you doing last month?
Not working.
What are you doing now?
Working.
I'm no Vanderbilt, but this train makes hay. So stop forgetting to buy your blades every month and start deciding where you're going to stack all those dollar bills I'm saving you. We are DollarShaveClub.com, and the party is on.
The most viral video on the internet. This happened to be the most viral video on the internet, 2013. Right? Costed $12,000. Most of it to rent out that warehouse. This didn't belong to him, of course. Rented out the warehouse. He's the founder, he shot the movie himself, saved money to the actors. So, you know, $12,000 to shoot the whole thing and then basically put this ad up and created a landing page where people can go sign up. 37,000 sign-ups in the first week of the video. But what was he trying to validate with the video? That he can make a funny video? No. That could be his second profession, probably. He's trying to validate two important things, right? The product or the service that they are offering is basically shaving blades for $1 versus competitors sell for $19, right? So what is that you're trying to validate? If you sell something for $1, will people associate it back to be cheap and bad and not buy it? Or would people say, no, even if it's $1, it's actually what I actually need and that's good enough, I should go buy this. Right? Will actually people buy, or will people assume that this is cheap, which basically means it's bad quality and won't buy it? That's a very important hypothesis to validate, right? Yes? Second hypothesis they wanted to validate. Subscription. would people actually subscribe for something like this? Because the software claims that they can predict there is a certain rate at which you consume shaving blades. Right? It's not like this month you use 2 shaving blades, next month you use 15, the month after that you will use 20. Right? There's a very well set pattern that every month you use X number of shaving blades. Right? So instead of you having to remember when to order them and things like that, the software will remember and give you the, send you the blades automatically. So you don't have to basically go forget the blades, you know, don't forget to buy your blades is what he was kind of talking about. Right? So that was the second hypothesis that they wanted to validate, if people would automatically, if people would like the subscription-based model. And to validate both, one video and one landing page. This is another way to hack your MVP. Did he have a warehouse where he had all the blades staffed so when the order comes he can ship it? No, didn't even have the logistics or any of that stuff figured out. Right? But first, will people order the blades? Instead of going and building this whole inventory and everything and then figuring out no one cares about this. Just a quick side note, this was not how they launched their company. They had already launched their company. They tried, it didn't really work. They kind of hit and then they kind of pivoted and this was what they tried to do, right? So this is not the launch of the company. This was a pivot of the company, DollarShaveClub.com. Today there are like 20 other similar companies, which basically means that they have really found a model which works and everybody else is now imitating that. To the extent that Gillette has now launched a $2 shaving blade. Right, which used to be $19 earlier. That's what means disruptive change in the market. I was talking about a startup I did earlier. This was called Adventure Labs. And at Adventure Labs, what we were trying to do is, basically we were trying to help kids get better at mental arithmetics. You know, we believe that kids can calculate faster than a calculator. We have a whole bunch of kids who can actually calculate faster than a calculator. And it's not that you have to be born genius to do that. You actually, it's a skill that you can acquire. It takes about 2 years of practice. And basically Abacus and Vedic Maths, combination of the two, can actually help kids age 5 and 6 really learn how to calculate faster than the calculator. They can remember up to about 100 numbers in the same sequence. You know, they build very good, the overall brain development happens very good. So we said we want to do something like this, and we said the problems with the existing Abacus-based teaching techniques is that there is no feedback that you get. Even if you were doing things wrong, you wouldn't get a feedback unless a teacher was standing over your shoulders and watching. And most schools that teach this would have 50 kids with one teacher. So it's not practical for the teacher to watch what the kids are doing all the time. Right? So it takes about on an average 2 years for kids to get good at it. So our hypothesis was that kids can learn this much faster if they get instant feedback. If they get feedback very quickly, almost like in a game, right? In a game, you get very quick feedback, so your skills improve very fast, right? Or in real world. In real world, you get very quick feedback. If you put your finger into the fire, it doesn't take a week before you realize it's burning, right? So that was kind of our hypothesis. We believe this stuff, and so we try to come up with an electronic abacus. Basically, that was our idea, that we will come up with an electronic abacus which will solve this particular problem. So we came up with a, you know, kind of a prototype for how to build an electronic abacus, all of that stuff. But obviously we realized that that's going to be very expensive to do this whole, you know, fabrication of this electronic abacus and stuff like that, and then to test it out and stuff. So as a hack, we came up with the idea of why not basically just, you know, use something that's available in the Apple App Store. We found an abacus game. So we said, why not just, you know, pick that abacus thing and use that as a way to validate if instant feedback is given to kids, will they learn things much faster? That was our kind of fundamental hypothesis, right? The leap of faith. So we actually tested this out. What we found is kids were able to learn how to recognize, how to represent numbers on the abacus almost 7 times faster. We repeated that test with all different kinds of kids, and we found that kids were able to learn how to represent numbers on the abacus about 7 times faster. So we said, well, this actually proves the hypothesis that if you give instant feedback through some kind of a thing, it actually works. And we also realized, why do an electronic abacus? Why not just do a tablet-based software, tablet-based app, which will help kids do this? So we kind of built a whole storyline, whole bunch of stuff, and we kept testing it out. One of the things with the abacus is every day you need to practice for 10 minutes. If you miss practicing, then those mental models don't build up quite, you know. So it's about rote learning in some sense. It's about tuning. It is about making practicing your brain. So one of our challenges was, how do we ensure that the kids will keep coming back every day and practice for 10 minutes? So we came up with this idea of basically feeding. We came up with a character, and we said if you had a character, then you fed the character. If you don't practice, you don't get points, which means your character will not be fed and the character will die. So we basically built that storyline. We tested it out with a bunch of kids. We gave them actually, you know, this thing to kind of see if they would actually go back and test this every day. And what we found is actually kids were doing, majority of the kids were going back because they had this attachment with the character. So, you know, one thing at a time, we had a hypothesis, we hacked a really small thing, and we tested it out with the kids. You know, we were trying to visualize how their brain power is improving and stuff like that. At this point, we basically ran out of money because we had spent so much kind of trying out, testing out, doing little things. We have not even built the actual product. We're still trying to figure out what the actual product should look and feel like, right? So at this point, we had spent a lot of money. And so we said, let's launch this. Let's basically go and have a tie-up with some other company, like a Pearson or a Kaplan or one of these companies, because they are big players in this game and they'll be able to invest in this particular product. So we went, spoke to them, they looked at the idea, they looked at what we had done. They said, brilliant idea, too futuristic, will not work, right? And we heard that repeatedly over and over again from people. So we said, screw them, we're gonna just put this little thing on the you know, Google Play Store and stuff like that. And so we basically built a really small, tiny app. This is the first time we actually built something. Before this was all mostly experiments, either using Keynote to generate a video or things like that. This is the first time we actually built something, put it in the App Store. We were, I think, number 4 on the Google Play Store. We had about 100,000 downloads in 4 days. And then we took that data, and then we went back to these companies saying, while you said it's too futuristic, here we have 100,000 downloads. We are number 4 on the US Play Store. So wouldn't this be interesting for you? And they said, no, this still doesn't make sense and stuff like that. And after that, we basically gave up. Right, so at this point, we had spent a significant amount of money, we self-funded the whole thing, and we gave up. I mean, we gave up in the sense we felt that there was no real market for this. Even though, you know, what we had validated was a lot with the actual users. What we had not validated was the channel, the distribution, how we are actually be able to distribute this. And that's what kind of was our key learning out of this, is that, you know, you need to sell before you build. Otherwise, you will validate with the users, you would figure out a right product for them, all of that stuff, but you don't have a distribution channel. So, you know, it might not work even though you had a great product because you don't have a distribution channel. That was kind of our key learning. Quick commercial break. I've been talking about all this while, but I don't know how many people know who I am, what is my background, why do I come here. So my name is Naresh Jain. I live in Mumbai. Don't act yet in Bollywood, someday. People familiar with Bollywood here? Yeah. I was a partner at a company called Industrial Logic. We built e-learning. That's how my background in e-learning comes from, and why I started building the kids thing. Is we built this e-learning. This was funded by Google. All Google employees go through this to learn some skills. After that, I basically founded Adventure Labs, which is where we built these games for kids. Didn't go anywhere. Did a bunch of other random stuff. I started the Agile movement in India back in 2004. We put together the Agile Software Community of India, which is a non-profit body through which we've been running conferences. Over the years, I've become like a conference guy. A lot of other conferences I've been running in India, functional programming conferences, jQuery, Selenium conferences, and so on. because I run a lot of conferences and mostly it's me doing it on my own, I ended up trying to automate a lot of stuff that happens when you have to put a conference together, like getting speakers' proposals together, creating the schedules, managing the travels, dealing with sponsors, all of that stuff. So I founded another company called Confingent, which is basically like a platform for managing conferences and things like that. And this is right now the startup that I've been building the last couple of years. So that gives you a quick background. These are companies or places where I've worked as a consultant or as an employee. Kind of gives you a quick gist of the different domains I've worked in my over the years, 15 plus years now. That brings us to the main topic of this particular session, which is, while MVP is the thing, what is the reasoning behind MVP, right? We saw a few examples of how people have hacked MVPs. We saw first two examples of what people tried to do with the product and they're lucky to pivot and find a solution. But what's the underlying thread between all of this, right? What am I trying to get at? Is action precedes clarity. Has anyone heard this phrase before? Action precedes clarity. A lot of times we have all this theory about how things work, but it doesn't make sense. When you start doing something, that's when it starts making sense why this is working this way, or this is working this way, or it's not working this way. So in a world which is a complex adaptive world, you cannot really have a theory and that theory can be applied everywhere, which is why you have some theory, but it has to be contextualized in your case. And you need to find cheaper, faster ways of validating your product strategies. So there is MVP, there is all that theory, but I'll tell you honestly, a lot of that stuff will not work when you try to do it. It's like copying someone else's hairstyle, doesn't really work on you, right? So you need to find for your own, and you need to find cheaper ways of trying to do this. That brings us to the topic of safe fail experimentation, and we're going to spend some time talking about safe fail experimentation, why safe fail experimentation is important, and what's kind of the genesis behind the whole MVP thinking is essentially the safe fail experimentation. So let's assume that you guys here in this room were given the task to design the traffic system, a system to control the traffic lights or the traffic, basically not just the traffic lights, but to control the traffic system of the busiest intersection of the world. Imagine there were like 8-9 big highways coming all at the same point, right? And you had to design a system that would ensure what? That there's no congestion at those intersections. Traffic flowed smoothly through that, right? So what I want you to do is I want you to work in smaller groups in your table and come up with a model or come up with a solution of how you're going to actually validate that your idea of how to solve this particular problem will work, right? So you need to come up first with an idea of how to design a traffic management system for the busiest intersection of the world, and then tell me how you're sure that this idea will actually work, right? So I'm going to give you 10 minutes each table. You're going to work at your table with the other people, and you have to come up with the solution for designing the traffic control system for the busiest intersection, and also how you're going to validate it, that it works, without actually having to build the whole thing. Yeah? So 10 minutes, let's start. So quick check, right? What are all the different solutions? Did you guys first explore all the different solutions that are available today? What are the solutions available today for managing traffic? Traffic lights? Flyovers? Sensors, what will sensors help you do? Yeah, but that is collecting data, but how do you manage, right? So one is traffic lights. You have traffic lights and you manage the flow. Another is you build flyovers, so you avoid intersections, right? That's the second thing. The third, any other?
Roundabouts.
Roundabouts, or what we call, you call it here also roundabouts, right? Because different countries call it differently, so I don't know what you call it here. In India, we call them circles, we don't call them roundabouts. Obvious, right? Circles. What do you mean roundabout?
Highway.
These are highways coming and intersecting, right? So you could avoid the intersection, build flyovers, you could have traffic lights, you could have roundabouts. What else? Any other solution anyone's thinking of? Introducing alternative path, bypass roads. So people don't get there at all. They go through a bypass road, they go somewhere else, they cut through, right? They don't even hit the intersection. Make roads one way. So, you know, you make roads one way, so then, you know, there is, you know, possible avoid, you can avoid to some extent, at least reduce the amount of intersections.
Similar to flyovers, maybe subways?
Flyovers, subways, yeah. Underground passes, other kinds of things.
Changing the route, possible.
Yeah, so that's a bypass, basically providing bypass so people don't even come there, they directly just go somewhere else.
Regulations.
What kind of thing? So have timings or things like that to regulate the flow of traffic, right? Only certain kinds of vehicles can go, only certain kinds of vehicles, like in China, only certain number plates can run on certain days of the week, right? All different kinds of things people have come up with to manage the flow, to regulate the flow. Any other ideas?
Carpooling
to reduce the amount of traffic. Right? Lots of different solutions. Now you have to pick one or two, maybe more, right? Combinations of few, and come up with a solution. And then you have to discuss amongst yourself, how do we know this solution is going to work? Because we're going to be investing pretty significantly, right? It's going to be disrupting what's going on. So it's a pretty significant investment. If you're talking about building flyovers, that's going to be a massive multi-crore, multi-million dollar investment to build those flyovers or bypass or whatever. Do we know that's going to work? What assumptions have we made? What's the riskiest assumption? I want you to get into that thinking process, right? What's your riskiest assumption? How are you going to validate that riskiest assumption before you go and build the whole thing? This makes it very obvious because it's, you know, literally building roads and stuff like that, right? So how do you do your MVP in that sense? Identifying your riskiest assumption and validating that assumption. How do you do that? That's what I kind of want you to start thinking about. That's what this exercise is about. So I see some groups talking about collecting data, going and analyzing what's going on today, getting all that data and then basically making decisions based on that. Good idea, but bad approach. Not going to work because the traffic situation is not static. It's not the same every day. The traffic flow is very dynamic. It keeps changing, right? It's not the same every day. If there's a big football match happening and there's a stadium out there, then that one day there's going to be a massive surge, right? And then the rest of the day there's nothing going on. So which day you're going to do your study, you completely skew your data. Or day of the week, if there's a big company, people traveling there, there's certain times that people go and come. All of these things, is what I'm trying to get at is, you know, if you're thinking about analyzing data, you have to think about it more holistically, and these patterns are going to change. These patterns are not going to remain the same. This is the solution, right? Once you do this, people will leave their cars, they'll just walk. They can't figure out what to do. That is like Christmas tree, yeah, correct. So this is a terrible idea. This is not how you're going to solve this problem. You're not going to use a structured way of problem solving, right? There are different ways of problem solving. One way is the structured way of business solving. The Americans, which are idiots, will go do this. Right. This is actually a real example. So what they did is basically they cleared out that area and they started putting these cones and, you know, those small bags, and they kept moving them based on how they saw the traffic was flowing to figure out what pattern might stabilize the traffic, what pattern might allow it to flow smoothly. So they kind of kept experimenting by just moving these bags and moving these, you know, those orange color cones that you see. and they kept moving them to figure out if some patterns would allow the traffic to flow smoothly or not, till they figured out what pattern would actually stabilize, and they ran that over a year to basically see if it actually stabilizes. And they came up with what is referred to as the magic roundabout, a roundabout to a roundabout, right? The aerial view of this looks like this. Interestingly, what they found was different people took different paths, right? So someone who regularly goes through this would cut through the whole thing. A tourist would essentially go all around and go. But traffic flowed smoothly, irrespective, right? It allowed, it gave people who are familiar with it take an advantage, people who are not familiar still be safe, but take a longer route, right? So it's kind of accommodative of different kinds of people, different sizes of vehicle and things like that. And this is what they kind of ran and ran those experiments and figured out. And it was a cheap experiment because it was not a significant investment in terms of cost to do something like this, right? So this is kind of a thinking process of how you actually take a large complicated problem and try to do a safe fail experiment. It's okay to fail in these kind of things because you've not started building a massive, you know, flyover. You're just trying to figure out what patterns will work, what will not work, maybe, you know, stabilize the traffic a little bit through using this and then look at alternative solutions on top of it. But this is kind of a quick, cheap way to validate something, right? Just one thought process. Safe fail experimentation basically is again trying to experiment freely and expect failures. You will expect things will fail. It is safe to fail in these kind of things. Right? You start with an experiment where failure can be tolerated. Design experiments that can be monitored. So you can actually see the flow of traffic and you can visualize how things are. Is it taking longer for people to now go through or is it taking shorter? So you can actually measure things and make some more informed decisions. You run multiple of these in parallel, so you know which one is doing better than the other or not. And this is kind of the whole thinking process behind this thing. So I ran another startup, almost not a startup, but just an project, where this is for companies in India who provide employees cabs to get to office and go back to office. Do you have something similar here? Once the IT industry here grows to a size, then offices will all move to remote parts of the world, and then you'll have to travel 2 hours each way to the work, right? And so the offices will have to provide cabs for people to get to office and come back. But what they wanted to do is that they wanted to minimize the cost, improve the efficiency of the cabs utilization in the company. And they wanted to basically reduce the time it takes for employees to get to work. Right, because if they took a longer route or whatever, then it's a loss for the company because employees are traveling more, right? Things like that. So if this is a problem given to you, how would you go about doing a minimum viable product design for this? What would you do? Start building the whole software day one? You might be a frequent traveler in one of those cabs, but you might have perspective only from your point of view. You might not know what other kind of problems exist for other point of view. So what we do is something called as a product discovery. So we went through this kind of a product discovery, kind of came up with the idea of first capturing what the different problems are and kind of trying to visualize those for people and put some measurable things around those. And then we started kind of doing multiple different experiments in parallel. And one of this was kind of using low fidelity prototypes to, you know, run these experiments with people to actually figure out if we went down and designed a system, will that actually help people solve this problem? We're not kind of measuring on the road, but we're trying to figure out at least, you know, from a collection data point of view and things like that, to break the problems down into smaller chunks. Finally, what came out was basically using Google to help people figure out a route that they want to take and then basically sign up, fill in the details when they want to come into the office, when they want to go out in the office, create a schedule and then kind of generate a report that to using Google again to generate a report of what kind of people can be clubbed together. This was about 3 days worth of effort. right? So once we came up with this, we started seeing whether there were patterns or things like that. This was our MVP to figure out whether if you used caps to optimize them and you use Google Maps to kind of regulate who to design the routes and to club people together, will that work or not, right? So instead of going having built the whole thing, we're just simply using Google at this point to collect this data and then visualize the maps, the routes and stuff like that, right? Making any sense? This is not about going and building the whole product. This is about trying to figure out if people's routes, that's the most important assumption, right? That you can actually club people's routes in an effective manner. That kind of is the most riskiest part of this. So trying to highlight, capture that and quickly try to see if you can leverage some existing technology to try and find if that can be solved. What I'm trying to get at through all of this is that, you know, in all the examples, we had a vision of what we wanted to do. We wanted to achieve something. And the vision usually is kind of a grandiose vision. In Adventure Labs' case, we believe that kids can be faster than a calculator, and that's our vision, that we want to enable kids who can do that. In case of Green Light, they wanted to provide clean energy to the world, right? So different companies had different kinds of vision. Each vision has a set of different strategies that can be used to achieve the vision. A vision can be achieved via many different strategies. You typically, a lot of times we only look at one strategy and we decide and we go ahead with that, right? But most often to achieve any vision, there are many different strategies, right? In our case, we chose to build a game on the tablet. That was a strategy. The other strategy could have been to create classrooms all around the world that students can go and attend that. Right? These are all different strategies which helps us achieve the vision, right? We pick the strategy that we like the most. We come up with each strategy is based on certain hypotheses. So we highlight those hypotheses. We kind of flush out those hypotheses. We say what are the hypotheses on which this strategy is based, the riskiest assumption on which this strategy is based. Then we run a set of safe fail experiments. Right? Then we run a set of safe fail experiments to get some validated learning on these strategies and their hypotheses. Then we refine our strategy. And then we iterate through this process till you can find a viable solution. And you do this in as cheap and as fastest way as possible. And using some of the lean, using some of the safe fail experimentation, you want to make this safe to fail, where failure is acceptable. And you want to run multiple of them in parallel because they are cheap and you want to go fast. Right? Making any sense? Let's look at another video, and I want to tie this back into how, you know, successful leaders and companies actually operate and why this actually is very similar to what they do. So this is a quick video.
How do you explain when things don't go as we assume? Or better, how do you explain when others are able to achieve things that seem to defy all of the assumptions? For example, why is Apple so innovative? Year after year after year after year, they're more innovative than all their competition. And yet, they're just a computer company. They're just like everyone else. They have the same access to the same talent, the same agencies, the same consultants, the same media. Then why is it that they seem to have something different? Why is it that Martin Luther King led the civil rights movement? He wasn't the only man who suffered in a pre-civil rights America, and he certainly wasn't the only great orator of the day. Why him? And why is it that the Wright brothers were able to figure out control-powered man flight, when there were certainly other teams who were better qualified, better funded, and they didn't achieve powered man flight. The Wright brothers beat them to it. There's something else at play here. About 3.5 years ago, I made a discovery. And this discovery profoundly changed my view on how I thought the world worked, and it even profoundly changed the way in which I operated it. As it turns out, there's a pattern. As it turns out, all the great and inspiring leaders and organizations in the world, whether it's Apple or Martin Luther King or the Wright brothers, they all think, act, and communicate the exact same way, and it's the complete opposite to everyone else. All I did was codify it. and it's probably the world's simplest idea. I call it the golden circle. Why, how, what? This little idea explains why some organizations and some leaders are able to inspire where others aren't. Let me define the terms really quickly. Every single person, every single organization on the planet knows what they do 100%. Some know how they do it, whether you call it your differentiating value proposition or your proprietary process or your USP. But very, very few people or organizations know why they do what they do. And by why, I don't mean to make a profit. That's a result. It's always a result. By why, I mean what's your purpose? What's your cause? What's your belief? Why does your organization exist? Why do you get out of bed in the morning? And why should anyone care? Well, as a result, the way we think, the way we act, the way we communicate is from the outside in. It's obvious. We go from the clearest thing to the fuzziest thing. But the inspired leaders and the inspired organizations, regardless of their size, regardless of their industry, all think, act, and communicate from the inside out. Let me give you an example. I use Apple because they're easy to understand and everybody gets it. If Apple were like everyone else, a marketing message from them might sound like this. We make great computers. They're beautifully designed, simple to use, and user-friendly. Want to buy one? Meh. And that's how most of us communicate. That's how most marketing is done, that's how most sales is done, and that's how most of us communicate interpersonally. We say what we do, we say how we're different or how we better, and we expect some sort of behavior, a purchase, a vote, something like that. Here's our new law firm. We have the best lawyers with the biggest clients. We have, you know, we always perform for our clients, do business with us. Here's our new car. It gets great gas mileage, it has, you know, leather seats. Buy our car. But it's uninspiring. Here's how Apple actually communicates. Everything we do, we believe in challenging the status quo. We believe in thinking differently. The way we challenge the status quo is by making our products beautifully designed, simple to use, and user-friendly. We just happen to make great computers. Want to buy one? Totally different, right? You ready to buy a computer from me? All I did was reverse the order of the information. What it proves to us is that people don't buy what you do, people buy why you do it. People don't buy what you do, they buy why you do it. This explains why every single person in this room is perfectly comfortable buying a computer from Apple. But we're also perfectly comfortable buying an MP3 player from Apple, or a phone from Apple, or a DVR from Apple. But as I said before, Apple's just a computer company. There's nothing that distinguishes them structurally from any of their competitors. Their competitors are all equally qualified to make all of these products. In fact, they tried. A few years ago, Gateway came out with flat screen TVs. They're eminently qualified to make flat screen TVs. They've been making flat screen monitors for years. Nobody bought one. Dell came out with MP3 players and PDAs. And they make great quality products, and they can make perfectly well-designed products, and nobody bought one. In fact, talking about it now, we can't even imagine buying an MP3 player from Dell. Why would you buy an MP3 player from a computer company? But we do it every day. People don't buy what you do, they buy why you do it. The goal is not to do business with anybody, with everybody who needs what you have. The goal is to do business with people who believe what you believe.
Okay, so, you can watch the entire TED video. It's a 20-minute long video, but the gist of the video is essentially captured, and what I wanted to kind of compare that with is basically the model that we are trying to put here together, is basically the why is your vision, right? Which rarely changes. You pretty much stick to your vision. The strategy is the how, and you kind of keep changing your strategy of how you achieve it. And the product or the service that you offer is essentially the what part of it, right? So what should be the goal of your MVP? Talking about MVP hacks, right? So what should be your goal of MVP? Is it to figure out what features to build? That's where a lot of MVPs are stuck, is to trying to figure out what features to build. Or is it about figuring out what strategy to use? Partly. But most importantly is to figure out what is the why that will appeal to people, that will connect to people. right? Because then rest of it will not be as important and you will figure those things out. But if you can figure out the why and you figure out how to connect to people, right, that's very important. So my hypothesis is that if you're designing an MVP, you focus on trying to validate the why. First articulate the why for yourself and then figure out how to do the why. And then of course use the safe fail experimentation techniques to find out if the why that you have in mind actually connects with people. Right? So that's kind of trying to draw the comparison and going back to what we had previously here is around this, is how you think about this and you evolve, because your goal is to figure out what appeals to people and which strategy is going to help you get there and how you can run safe fail experiments to figure this thing out. Right? That's kind of what to me the purpose of an MVP is. And you need to find hacks to go through this process very quickly, very efficiently. And you know, the lesson at least for me in my previous startup was that we focused too much just on the user, didn't focus on the other aspects of the vision, which is the channel distribution and other kinds of things. You need to validate all of these things, right? They all have to fit together and different things might, you know, work with different sets of audiences. So you need to go through this very quickly and figure that out. There's a lot of books written on this subject, on the whole lean startup and the lean thinking and how to do lean canvas and other kinds of things. I think once you kind of understand this whole underpinning of what you're trying to achieve, when you go back and read these books, they start making a lot more sense. They start putting a lot more, you know, structured thoughts into your mind in terms of how you can go through that entire cycle from the vision all the way to a validated learning and back. Okay. That's kind of quick run through with some of these things. Now I'm open for questions. I'm pretty much at the end of the talk. So do you guys have any questions at this point? I did a whole bunch of random things and hopefully you were able to connect the dots between them, right? Or you want me to kind of slow down and explain some of those things? Yep. The dots are connected. Makes sense? Like, why did we do the traffic problem? Just to highlight the importance of safe fail experimentation, how you go about thinking of safe fail experiment, taking that and applying back to your product. Right? How do you do that? It could be at a new product level, that could be at a new company level, that could be at a new feature level. The same thinking process can be applied for safe fail experimentation. Later this afternoon I have a talk on, you know, basically kind of it is a rant around how agile is completely gone to dogs. And you know, there I'll touch a little bit more upon, you know, what are the kind of things that is missing that some of this thinking can help the agile community. From the point of view of running safe fail experiments in parallel, you know, having a lot more autonomy and stuff like that. So that, you know, like we talk a lot about collaboration, and I'm going to talk about some of the bad things about collaboration. What are the side effects of collaboration, right? Things like that, which I think we kind of are not really focusing on, but these are important problems. Neil talk about estimation and touch upon some of those things as well in terms of, you know, now when you go back and ask, then if I'm to run an MVP and how do I do estimations on that and stuff like that, you know, people will start laughing if you go to startups and talk about these things. You can't really estimate some of these things. But the point is to go through them so quickly that it doesn't hurt you. Okay, so if there are any more questions, I'm happy to take them, else we can all go and enjoy a good lunch. How many people here work in startups? So most of what I said wouldn't make any sense to them. That's interesting. How many people aspire to have their own startup, build their own product? Few people, that's good. Hopefully this is giving you some thought process that you can take back and try and see if you want to aspire to build your own product, what are the kind of things you might want to you know, think about, prepare, and how you want to approach them. Yeah? Cool. Any questions? All right then, thank you so much.